Welcome back. So what is a decision tree? Before we begin, I just want to front load that we're going to look at a Google Colab notebook, and we're also going to go to Wikipedia. I'll warn you again, but when we go to Wikipedia, we're going to go from dark mode to light mode, and it's really bright. So just a heads up there. And so when we discuss what is a decision tree, we're going to talk about the concepts, but more importantly, we're going to talk a lot about what they look like, because that's, I think, the easiest way to understand a decision tree. And then we'll look at Wikipedia, which has different examples, all the way from handwriting, like traditionally they would, their decision points, do we do this or do we do that, and you could write it out. And then it kind of evolves into more programmatic flows and then charts, and that's what we're going to take a look at. All right, so let's answer the question, what is a decision tree? And as I mentioned, we already talked about linear and logistic regression, and LDA, which includes QDA, and these are discriminant analysis. And then we talked about naive Bayes. But when we're thinking about a decision tree, they take a different approach. I've said that multiple times already. It's a non-parametric approach. And in essence, what that is a decision tree is like a flowchart, or I can say flowchart-like tree structure, where each internal node represents some kind of a decision on a feature, and each branch represents an outcome of that decision, something like this. So this would be the decision, and this is a choice. So it makes a choice, and then there's an outcome of that decision. And then here is the final decision, or you could say prediction, on some kind of a class or a value. They essentially split the data based on feature values recursively. And a quick note, depending on what your current domain is, or your domain knowledge is about decision trees or random forests or ensemble methods, one good way to assess that is just to see if you can answer the questions in this scale. Because as we talked about earlier in the very beginning of this course, everybody's going to be coming from a different, or all data scientists are not the same. They're coming from different places. So if you don't have a programming background or you don't know decision trees, then that's why I'm kind of laying it out. But if you know this stuff, I definitely want you to skip ahead. And one good way is to actually answer the quiz questions and see if you don't understand some concept, then watch the video. But definitely, you know, skip based on your current knowledge. I'm kind of doing this the thorough way, so I don't miss anybody. But if you already know what a decision tree is and random forest, then this might not be the most useful. What I would suggest, in addition to just taking the quiz questions to see what you know, look at the finished Colab notebook. There's going to be a lot of code there. If you look at that and you're like, I don't know about this, then maybe go back to the section where I start to write the code. But definitely it's up to you to find your knowledge gaps, what sort of gaps you have in your domain knowledge as it applies to each part or each concept, because this is a wide array of domains for this DataX exam. And I just wanted to put that out there just to remind you that that's totally acceptable. And in fact, that's kind of necessary, unless you feel that you want to watch it all. You know, I'm that kind of person. I like to be very thorough. So I'll watch things where I don't totally need to know it, just to make sure that I'm understanding how they all connect down the road. I don't mind taking the extra time. And if you're like that, then let's continue. But if not, I wanted to just remind you that it's okay to jump around, to just make sure that you're covering your individual knowledge gaps. So let me move down here. So let's talk about classification when we're thinking about decision trees. So a common splitting criterion, because we're not using a decision boundary, so you have to have a way to split it. And so a splitting criterion, or split criterion, could be impurity, or entropy. And we'll also discuss information gain. In essence, what we're doing here is that we're measuring how pure the classes are, how homogeneous they are, if we split based on a particular feature threshold. So we'll get into that a little bit later. So just wanted to sort of outline that. But if we're thinking about regression, typically we're using variance reduction. That's what we're trying to minimize. The trees grow by picking the best feature and threshold that yield the best split. So we're trying to maximize best split, and we're doing so recursively. So again, the tree grows by picking the best feature and threshold that's going to give us the best split, then recursively doing so on each subset of data. All right, so now, how about interpretation? I mentioned already that if you do this programmatically, it's not super easy to interpret, especially if you're presenting this to a non-technical audience, but they can be visualized. And this shows the series of questions asked and how we arrived at a prediction. And they handle both numeric and categorical data. Often we need to encode these for categories, so keep that in mind. And they can model non-linear relationships by branching structures and interactions between features. And the takeaway here is trees can overfit, and they can do so easily if they're too deep, meaning if we have perfectly fit training data by creating a bunch of small branches. But there's techniques like pruning, and this stops growth early or cuts back growth after the fact. And this is how we can mitigate, put an arrow there, mitigate overfitting. We're almost at the code section, but we have a little bit more here. I want to talk about some of the characteristics of decision trees. So let's say decision trees, we could say that they're non-parametric and they're hierarchical, and they use a hierarchy. And this, I guess we could say that it means that there's no fixed equation. So the structure grows from the data, and it can handle mixed data types without feature scaling. But it is also sensitive to small variations. We'll expand on all of this as we start to progress through the skill. And most importantly, a small tree might underfit, and a large tree might overfit. So you want to get the right, or let's say focus on the right complexity. And you could do that by controlling parameters like max depth, minimum samples, or min samples leaf. These are scikit-learn examples, which we're going to use. All right, so before we dive into a decision tree in the code, I want to make sure that we understand how we can make a flowchart, which includes nodes and branches. We talked about leaves as well. So what are these? So we can say the individual parts would be root node, and then we can have a decision node, which are also called internal nodes, then leaf nodes. These are also called terminal nodes. So what is a root node? So this is usually the starting point. So every tree has a starting point, and it holds the entire data set, so the entire decision. And this is how we split the data. And that's the decision node. We make these decisions, and then we split the data. Or you can also say that we branch the decision based on particular criterion, such as feature threshold that we discussed earlier. And here, these are the end of the branch. So it's really nice to visualize a tree, you know. At the end of the branch, there's a leaf. It's easy to visualize. And this is where the final destination or classification happens. Or it could be a regression value as well. So let's go ahead and try to create a Python example using the simplest possible tree. So in this code example, we're going to use one root node, and it's going to split into two leaf nodes, leaf node one, leaf node two. Again, this is going to be tiny. So I will see you in the next video. We'll stop here, and then we'll jump into that Google Colab section. And remember, we are going to go to Wikipedia. It's going to be bright white, sort of like a bright white light. So we're in dark mode. So just keep an eye out for that. I thought it was going to be in this video, but we'll do it in the next one. All right. See you there. In this video, we're going to create a tree class and write a simple example. And now we're going to also quickly go to Wikipedia. So just remember, it's a bright white light. So put on some sunglasses, whatever you have to do, turn down the brightness on the monitor. And this is the start notebook that you're going to start with. I'm going to be using Finish because I'm going to fill it in, and then it's going to be finished, and that's going to be available for you as well. All right, so here's Wikipedia. All right, super bright white. So here, as I was mentioning earlier, this is a traditional decision tree, and it was created manually. So you see that you have these, let me click on this so we can take a look. So here's the initial starting point, and this is the complete decision. And then you have these branches and then these nodes, right? and then you end to some kind of a prediction here. So this is the end of those branches, and then you have these leaves. And so there's different shapes, so let's talk about it. And this is also going to be a resource for you. I'll include this link. And you see here, it says decision nodes, chance nodes, and end nodes. So keep in mind that the terminology will be slightly different, but the concept will be the same. So if we go down here, you can see a more programmatic version of a decision tree. What we're going to be doing is going top down. This goes left to right. Trees usually don't grow that way. They grow top down or bottom up. So more like vertical instead of horizontal. But this is nice to look at. So you'll see them in both ways. And then this is what I was saying. This is more of a vertical sort of flow chart. And you have these different symbols, but you can see that you have an initial starting point. And then here's a decision. So you can either go here or over here. So 40%, 60%. And based on these criteria, you make decisions and then you come to either an offer down here or you proceed, and here's some logic. If you scroll down here, this is more of a decision tree that we're going to create, but we are going to add a little bit of color, but this is a more Pythonic or programmatic approach. Here's an influence diagram. We're not going to get into that, but this is just to give you an idea. And I was looking for the impurity measures, but they don't even have that here. So we'll get into that. And I'm going to start here in the finish notebook. So the first thing I'm going to do is create a class and call it tree node. And if you don't have object-oriented programming, we have a course here at CBT Nuggets to get you started. And that would be programming for data science. It includes a section that is more geared towards data scientists instead of Python programmers, which tend to get really deep into it, which is also nice. So you have a choice. So here we're going to just continue creating this by initializing it with a name, left. And again, if you don't know what this is, it's not super important to understand the concepts, but it's definitely helpful to brush up on OOP if you need to. Okay, so now we have the tree node. Now we can, or this class, and now we can create the node. So let's define the root node as tree node. Let me spell tree correctly. And then here we're just going to say root, and let's create a decision here. Let's say, you know, we're going to talk about cryptocurrency a little bit later. So let's go ahead and add that. Say decide to buy, or decide to buy Bitcoin, something like that. And then we can have a left leaf. This will make sense at the very bottom when we sort of run this. And call that class again, tree node. And then here we're going to have, this is a decision node, and then which is the root in this case, because it's a very, very simple tree, like the smallest tree that you could create. And here I'm going to say leaf, so that when we look at this, it'll make more sense. Here we're going to say buy equals yes. So there's going to be some sort of a condition or some sort of a logic, and then it's going to either buy it, or we call this right leaf. And then here we're going to say buy equals no. Let me make these all caps. Okay, so now what we want to do is link them here. And I'm going to say root. I'm going to do this twice, one for each branch, or one each leaf. So here's going to be left. And this is what we're doing here with the class left leaf. So we're just kind of linking them. Now left, then leaf. And here's right, right leaf. And again, this is a super, super simple example, and this is just to show us how it looks. So in order to do this, we need to print the tree. So I'm going to create a function here, print tree. It's going to it's going to take in a node and then a level. I'll define that to 0 for now. This will make sense when we print this out. So let's indent like that, multiplied by level, and now let's add some logic. If node is not none, then we're going to print indent plus node name. And then to see the tree, we're going to actually print the tree. So we're going to say, we're going to call the function here, print tree. We'll do this twice, for one for left and one for right. Node.left level. And then here we add one. Node right. We're going to do the same thing, and we add one. Okay, so that's great. Now we need to call that function, print tree, and pass in the node, or the root in this case. And that root is up here. All right, so let's see if this works. Drum roll, please. Okay, right is not defined because I have a comma there. I inverted those, a comma, and then, so it's period, then comma. All right, there we go. So we have the root node, and it says decide to buy Bitcoin, and then we have a leaf that says buy, and then we have another one that says no. So this is probably the simplest one that you can do. Now, this is not super informative because we're not visualizing it yet. So to visualize it, you'd have to, there's many ways you can do that. So if you just wanted to visualize it without actually running a model, you'd have to import GraphViz like that. And I'm just going to leave that there for you so you can learn more about this. But here's the output that I mentioned. So I did this because it's a lot of code. So I just wanted to skip that. Okay, so now here we have the Gini impurity measure. And we're getting 0.5. We'll talk about this and samples question mark. We'll get into that because we don't have any samples yet. But here is the smallest possible tree. You can make a decision of yes or no. And so based on some criteria, we could change this. We'll do that when we get into the IRIS data set. It'll make a decision. So either buy some Bitcoin, let's say that if it's a certain price or not. And so what does this other one look like here? All right, so just kind of what I was saying is that if Bitcoin price is greater than 30,000, right, which would be like, it's pretty high right now. But if let's say it was 30,000, then you would buy. And so, and here you have a number of samples and a class and an impurity measure. And then here it says, if altcoin sentiment is positive, then buy. So then here it would buy some altcoins, or if not, it would just buy some Bitcoin. So you, now you see a little bit bigger tree and some of the decisions that you can make. So here's the root node, and here's a decision node, and here are the leaf nodes, right? So you have one here, another one here, and then this is where you get that final output. At the end of the branch, you have the two leaves in this case. And so if you look at this, the output of this would be, and this is actually what we looked at here. That's what we printed out. So we probably don't need this. Okay, so I'm going to delete that here. And then we have the IRIS data set, and then we visualize the tree. So that's coming up. So let me close this. So we're pretty much done with the coding part. And let's see where we are in the section here. So this is what is a decision tree. And then here is visualizing the decision tree. And since we've already done that, I'm just going to write here, C Colab Notebook. All right, so we've got the first two sections done. And now we're going to, in the next video, answer the question, how do decision trees grow? See you there.